Welcome back to the show. Well, the lockdown misery is rolling on for millions in Sydney and Melbourne as the New South Wales Premier admits there's no way back to COVID zero.
Infectious diseases expert Professor Robert Boyd joins us now. Professor, thanks for your time this morning. How do you think we're tracking at the moment?
It's been a problem. For a whole week now, we've had 50 or more people every single day infectious in the community, spreading infection. So it can't be got on top of until those kind of numbers come down. We're well over 400 the last 2 days. You know, the hope is that we're going to plateau soon. The restrictions will bite. They will work. They are working in eastern Sydney and southern Sydney, Fairfield. But other areas are opening up. Canterbury, Bankstown, for example, Penrith. So it needs a lot more work.
What do you think needs to be done in order to try and get it back to COVID zero, and is that possible?
It's been a good move to shut down the state. It means that the spread into the country, which we've been very worried about and we've been observing for the last few days, will be diminished and should be controlled. What they're doing is already working, but it needs to be deepened and widened, and that's exactly what they've just done, and we'll see the impact of that over the next 5 to 7 days.
The issue you've got is, I mean, you talk about how many people are infectious in the community. We heard yesterday that there's 270 plus, which is still under investigation, which just goes to show that contact tracers, they're really under the pump, and it probably puts New South Wales a couple of weeks behind this spread.
It does. It'll be quite some weeks until we get it under control and get the numbers down. The contact tracers are working night and day, weekends, as they have to, and they've put on many hundreds of more in surge capacity. They need to be trained, and they need to learn fast, and they need to be effective within a few days of starting. So that's not easy when you haven't been trained in it for years on end. So it is a challenge. The system is under stress.
Now, across the board too, I mean, even people who are trying to appeal to, like, Queensland Health to try and get into the state to see loved ones who are very sick, you can feel the tension from behind the scenes as the system, you know, gets under more and more pressure.
It's a really, really hard situation. I was in the same boat a year ago, and I couldn't get into Queensland to see my dying sister. And, you know, those measures are tough. They're really hard on people, and people are stressed. Their mental health, their emotional health is under real pressure.
So given that the New South Wales Premier says that zero is impossible, do you agree with that, by the way?
Yes, it's looking that way. The Delta variant, because it's an RNA virus, because it can mutate so easily and change its spots, our immune system is constantly changing. It's constantly chasing the changes in the virus. So it's still under control by vaccination. We still know that the vaccination works, even on Delta variant. But it is so transmissible that getting it to zero, considering also that many people can asymptomatically carry and pass on the infection before they get any symptoms. So it's a really tough foe.
All right. Well, Professor, we appreciate your time this morning. Thank you.
Thanks, Professor. That huge boost to our vaccine rollout with the first batch of emergency Pfizer doses from Poland landing in Sydney overnight. Let's bring in infectious disease expert Professor Mary Louise McClaws. Professor, always good to talk to you. What does this say about the rollout when we need to ask Poland for help?
Good morning, Carl. It says that our portfolio of vaccines were not enough, and the amounts were never enough, nor was the diversity as well, because we have had many people say that they can't take AstraZeneca, not just for medical reasons, but for religious reasons, and also vegans don't like a vaccine that's been trialled on an animal. So now that we're getting this new batch, this is great news, because there's only, at the very most, there should be 28 days between the first and the second dose of Pfizer, which means we can get our young adults vaccinated much faster, because the first dose, Carl, will reduce their risk of severe infection and death. But it's the second dose that reduces that cycle of infection and transmission, because that's when the probability really comes into play that you are at much less risk of a symptomatic disease.
Well, I, for one, am incredibly disappointed. I've given Australia support for the US over the years in multiple wars, that we weren't helped out here.
I agree. I think that our allies should have helped us out. It's very sad. But thankfully, we have a new ally who may give us some of theirs and other allies. But yes, it is very disappointing. And, you know, they're going into a new pattern of boosting, giving a third shot now. They're starting with those who are immunosuppressed, who've had their two doses, and they're now going into their third. But nevertheless, you would have hoped that they would have remembered us.
Gladys Berejiklian says that COVID zero is nigh impossible. Firstly, do you agree with that? And do you believe the measures over the weekend will work, or does more need to be done?
Oh, Carl, we've now got 7,818 cases, of which 7,760 odd occurred after the lockdown. So thankfully, we do have a lockdown, but it should have been tougher right from the beginning. These new additions will help. And of course, getting vaccinated will help eventually, but only when people have their second dose very soon afterwards. In other words, with something like Pfizer, because with AstraZeneca, you need a minimum of 6 weeks between. Some people say four. And yes, it will still stop them from dying, but it's still a long way. 4 weeks, 6 weeks, whatever that interval between the second between the first and the second dose is still a very long way off, isn't it? It's a month. So they all have to be vaccinated today so that we could then say in a month's time we've cut that infection transmission cycle. So I do think, though, that the Premier could lift some restrictions, but not all of them. Because don't forget, if there's half of the adults in New South Wales vaccinated before she thinks about lifting off those restrictions, that's half of the adult population. That's only 40% of the total population. So that basically means that more than one in two people are unprotected if she starts to lift all of the restrictions. And that's far too dangerous.
Yeah, OK. So we've had a number of people from Melbourne over the weekend too suggest to us there should have been a curfew. Given, I mean, the only, I don't know who's out at night who's not mingling with people, apart from really essential workers, should a curfew be in place?
A curfew would have helped, certainly, because you can't sneak out under the cloak of darkness to go and see friends. But I think one of the most important things before we start putting a curfew in, Carl, is to find out who these 400-odd cases are each day. Now, we know that 100-odd were household, and that's very sad because you can't stop the spread within a household. But those are the 300. We should have much more granular information. Are they catching it at work? Should they have workplace testing? Should they have workplace vaccination? Or, as a curfew would suggest, bringing one in, that it's happening socially. So it really would help if the government started to provide us with this information.
Yeah, the traces are under the pump too at the moment, aren't they? Professor, thank you so much for your time as always. Ali?
It's a pleasure. Stay safe.
Thanks for joining us this morning. The biggest compliance blitz Sydney has ever seen is right now underway, with hundreds of police swarming the streets as part of Operation Stay at Home.
We're joined now by New South Wales Police Minister David Elliott, who has pushed really hard and for a while on this. David, good morning to you. Thanks for your time. Appreciate it. It took you long enough. Are you happy now?
Yeah, I am happy, Carl. I mean, the police were frustrated because of the way the public health orders were written meant that too many people were gaming the system and we needed that closed. I mean, we're not responsible for drafting the public health orders. We're responsible for enforcing them. And the police just found that it was no coincidence that the numbers kept going up because people were just ignoring the rules or trying to get around the rules, and there was nothing police could do about it. Mm.
So all the loopholes are closed now. Do you think that's going to make a difference? We're going to see more people doing the right thing?
I'd like to think all the loopholes are closed, but you know, people are smart and they'll still try to they'll still try to work a way around them. But yeah, I think so. I'm quietly confident that now that the community has got the message that we're not mucking around you won't be allowed to offer up excuses. The commissioner said on Saturday he makes no apology, and don't bother writing to him because he's not going to give anybody any leeway. And I think that's an appropriate message for people to hear. We want to get out this as quickly as possible, and we can't do that until we go through the difficult period.
Did you push for that so-called ring of steel?
No, because my view was always, and I think this was the view that I got from the police, was that if we had decent lockdown laws, if we had decent ability for compliance, well, then we wouldn't need a ring of steel because nobody would be going anywhere. Mm. And I think that's probably what we saw over the weekend. I mean, the anecdotal evidence that I've had back from media and politicians over the course of the weekend is that it was a very, very quiet weekend, considering comparing it to last weekend. Mm.
I mean, the issue you've got, people are looking for ways to get around the rules, to bend them a little bit. We're 7 weeks into this, and I think people are thinking, well, it's what, another seven or more, isn't it, but we've still got to face lockdown?
Well, we won't know until we start seeing the figures start going south. But you know, when you consider the great take-up over for the vaccine, as well as the and you combine that with the possibility of the numbers going down, yeah, you're quite right. I've said all along, I think October will be where the two lines meet. But I think what has happened is that after 7 weeks, people actually have realised that this isn't going away. And I think people are taking more personal responsibility. But it didn't stop police yesterday from issuing 500 fines, including 31 kids at a party on the beachside. So it's just we've still got a lot of work to do.
I don't know. I mean, a couple of kids getting together for a party during lockdown, 30, 50 kids, you know, 12 o'clock at night. What could go wrong?
That's exactly right. Doesn't you wait to the yours of that age?
No, I'm telling you right now, what happens, and we saw it in Victoria as well, the mind just boggles, I mean, with stupidity.
Oh, that's exactly right. Exactly. I mean, these are 15, 19-year-old kids who really should know better. It's not as if they're not exposed to the media messaging. They are exposed to the media messaging, and despite that, and I don't understand. I mean, I've got a 20-year-old, and I know exactly where he is at the moment because I've told him that if you're issued the fine, it's on you.
And big fines. I tell you what, though, it's a big ask of our police, isn't it? And to see them out and about doing a great job. Have you got the resources you need?
Yeah, we have. 17,000 police and rising. And of course, well, they're backed up by another 800 soldiers. And the Prime Minister said to me that if I need any more ADF personnel, the Army, Navy and Air Force are available, and they've been fantastic because they increase productivity for us. They allow us to spread the resources a little bit better. But, it is a difficult job. But you know what? The one thing that I've been very proud of is how agile the police have been. They've been able to change tack. They've been able to deploy at very short notices. They've been able to get concept of the public health orders very, very swiftly, because like I said, it takes me a couple of days to work out what the changes are, but these officers, you go out the next shift with new health orders and enforce them, and that's pretty impressive.
I get the feeling McFaul's been champing at the bit for these restrictions to be tightened. Just one final one. October puts this very firmly, I mean, we're talking about kids and their desire to get out and socialise, but it does put us firmly into HSC territory. And that's a lot of homeschooling. Will that continue, or is there a way around that?
Well, I mean, I'm only speaking as a dad with a HSC student at home at the moment. And I've got to say, I have been very impressed with the school, the way that they have adapted to it. And yeah, if this happened when you and I were kids, Carl, there's no way we'd be able to adapt like this because we wouldn't have had the technology to make it work. But I think you're going to find a very resilient year. The class of 2021 is going to be a very resilient year. I've been very impressed with the way my son's been interacting with the school and his classmates. Yeah, they're missing out on a few of the niceties of your final year, but let's just hope that the Department of Education and the various schools allow them to catch that up over the summer.
Okay.
Yeah, hats off to all of them.
Yeah, indeed.
Thank you for your time this morning, Minister. We appreciate it.